Welcome to Lurgio Middle School. I'm Bill Greiner, along with Chris Cameron. We're here to bring you play-by-play of the middle school finals.
Division I championship.
Yep, we've got Merrimack in the blue. They're the visitors in Bedford, a home seed, number one seed.
The Lurgio Lions.
Lurgio Lions. So these teams have met a couple times so far this year. Chris, what's the outcome then?
They met. The first game of the year, they met in Merrimack. Bedford was up 30 at halftime, and they wound up winning by, you know, in the 30s, close to 40. Right after the holiday break, they came back, and it was a two-point game. Lurgio won by two. Bedford played in and out. Sometimes they were up by 15. They let Merrimack back in, so it was a game of spurts. If anything, that gave Merrimack a lot of confidence because the talent is definitely heavily weighted in Lurgio's favor. They're the more talented, they're bigger, they're more athletic. But Merrimack is a very strong team. As you can see, they're physical. They're the only team that can match up physically with Bedford this year.
So for Merrimack, the key is what? Just being able to match up from a size and a strength perspective? They're not gonna outrun Bedford? They're not going to outshoot Bedford?
No, they're not going to. They want to slow this game down. They're not going to be able to run with Bedford. Bedford's big and they run. One of the keys that was the difference between the first game and the second game, and also in spurts, was how they handled Bedford's full court press. Bedford likes to go 2-2-1 full court trap. At Merrimack, they just could not handle it. It was just turnover after turnover, leading to easy points. When they played here about 6 weeks ago, they handled it very well, and they got easy shots off of it. So does Bedford come out and try to press them, or are they just going to sit back and play man-to-man?
Now, as far as Merrimack scoring goes, who would you look for that's got to really get hot and be consistent for Merrimack?
For Merrimack, they're balanced. I don't think there's no one coming in this game that Bedford's like, we got to shut him down. They're a balanced team. They're gonna play. You know, they're not as deep as Bedford. Bedford can play 8-9 guys and have no real drop off at all. Merrimack's not as deep, so they have more balance. But there's no superstars out here for Merrimack.
And for Bedford, who's got to get hot for Bedford to Bedford, really, you know, get out?
They kind of go with the way Glassman goes. Matt Glassman, who's an eighth grader. And most of the kids, you know, Coach Dorman through the years has played eighth graders. Matt has been one of the few players that got a lot of playing time as a seventh grader. But Glassman's key, Colby Gendron, number 55. He's big. He's 6'3", and he can shoot for threes from way downtown. So, you know, if Colby's hitting, but they're also tough inside with Eric Brown and Mike Renko. And Johnny Scully's another shooter that can't get hot and heat up in a hurry, like Vinny the Microwave.
Good. Well, they're about a minute away from getting set here, so we'll come back right before the opening tip-off and bring the game to you live. Now we're back, and they're going to introduce the Bedford lineup here, Chris. Well, Chris, we're looking at a pretty good...
Can you see the court?
Yeah, pretty good little crowd today here. Merrimack's brought a little contingent, too.
It is. It's a great atmosphere. You have two towns, bordering towns, and national rivalry at the high school level. Carries down all the way through the youth sports. These kids, a lot of these kids have been playing 6 years against each other as third graders in the Manchester Suburban Basketball League. So they're very familiar with each other. But this game scheduled for Saturday. We're supposed to be at a neutral site at new Nashville Community College. Bedford being the higher seed, the game was canceled. Got scheduled. Huge advantage, I think, to play on your home court front of your home fans. So we'll see how Merrimack handles that early on.
Absolutely. And out to take the tip is Danny McKillop from Merrimack and Mike Rinko from Bedford. They're just seconds away from getting this game underway. Bedford controls the tip. Gendron comes in with a shot. Nice little 6-foot jumper from the left side of the key.
Colby's at his best. Colby likes to sometimes fall in love with the three, but he's at his best when he's driving to the hoop because he's big and he's talented going to the hoop.
We got a kick there. The ball goes off Eric Brown's foot. Merrimack going to inbound.
Bedford's in a 2-3 off of the inbounds right here. They're close to a 5 count right here, and I think they got it.
Great defense by Bedford. You're right on it, that one, Chris. Excellent defense. Really, nobody able to get open there. And I think, I don't know if that's Merrimack's with a little bit of nerves.
I think it's nerves because it wasn't like Bedford was in a zone. They really weren't pressuring.
And Glassman gets Colby,
Merrimack's coming out trying to match up in a man-to-man right now, which could be tough for them.
Yeah, because they've got Bedford's got a pretty good size athletes. Advantage there. Glassman looks at the three, doesn't take it. Now he shoots a 2, and that goes in and out. Eric Brown with a good rebound there, battling for it, taken away by Merrimack. And pulsing it up court is Merrimack. Nice little pass in there. Good defense by Rinko. Rebound, that doesn't go either.
Eric's
loose ball. Merrimack fighting for the loose ball. Talbot has a shot, goes up, no good, and Gendron with the rebound.
Bedford's got to do a better job boxing out there. They just gave Merrimack 4 opportunities at that right there, and sometimes they just rely on their abilities a little bit too much.
Gendron with the ball, gets it across to Scully.
This is kind of a new offense that they put in late in the season, this kind of handoff weave. We'll see if they get any kind of looks out of that.
Scully's looking, he's got Brown. Brown looks at the three, fakes it, goes up, back out to Rinko. Rinko with a shot and in and out. Rebound pulled down by Talbot. And Merrimack real quick down the other way. Turnaround jump shot, no good by Darrell.
Mike Rinko's at his best going to the glass inside. His 15-17 footer is not his game. He's got to drive the ball to the glass.
I'll tell you, that's a couple times, Chris, where Merrimack has gotten back in transition really well against Bedford. There's a foul as Rinko looks to make a guy move there, and he'll go to the line shooting too. But you notice how Merrimack was very quick in transition. They had odd man breaks both times.
I agree, and I guess they're trying to push it maybe a little bit because we haven't seen them in the half-court set yet, and Bedford's got to do a better job getting back.
They're
just
not
lazy.
Back.
They're lazy getting back right now.
Rinko at the line to shoot too. Misses the front end of that one. With 6:23 left to go, it's a 2-0 ball game after that real quick score by Gendron. After that, it's been kind of quiet for scoring
balls.
And Rinko hits the second of his 2, so it's 3-0 Bedford.
It looks like Bedford's just settling back, maybe in a 1, they're in a 1-3-1 half-court trap, it looks like. They kind of trap whenever they can.
Merrimack does a good job holding onto the ball. Good pass inside. And Eric Brown with a good block there from behind.
The referees are kind of letting him play a little bit down low right there.
Glassman, he gets bumped, takes a shot, it's
That's
no good.
That's a full shot right there. They don't need that. If they're patient, they can get whatever shot they want.
Nice job by Scully. He goes in and he takes a steal. And it's 5-0 Bedford. Great defensive play there by Scully.
Merrimack's got to watch. This can get away from them a little bit here.
The Glassman presses.
Goes for the reach around.
Nice roller steal. Trying to throw it ahead. He's got Glassman, gets up, and he gets the ball batted right out. He went down hard, Chris.
Glassman came into this game with a sore tailbone. So
he looks like he's feeling it right now. He went down hard on that, and it was.
He's back up. He's going to shoot 2 right here. He's going to shoot 2.
The referee's checking with him to make sure that he's okay.
Any kind of turnovers, Merrimack is just going to turn it into a fast break going the other way.
Last one misses the first of those 2 shots, and number 10 comes out. Coming in for Merrimack right now is Andrew Michaud.
Merrimack's had their chances, Bill. They've missed.
That's 2 fouls already on Zach LaChance. So Merrimack's got a kid in foul trouble,
and he's one of their top players, and he's not. They don't go deep onto that bench either.
Yeah, Glassman hits the. Glassman is. You can see he's still feeling the effects of that hit.
And he's key to that. He handles the ball, but they have a lot of depth. Bedford, Scully can run the point.
Bedford's still in that trap. Baseline shot. That's no good. Battle for it. Good hustle by Merrimack to get it back out to the key. Shot, and that's in by Andrew Michaud, the guy who just comes in off the bench. So he comes off the bench and he gets Merrimack's first points of the game.
Yeah, that first hoop is always big. Once the first one falls.
6-2 with 5 minutes, 6 seconds left to go. An easy shot there, a miss by Rinko.
Jump ball, possession out of Merrimack.
We got a sub coming in there.
Glassman looks like he's banged up. He might not be able to go.
Mazzurri comes in and Glassman checks out of the game. So Bedford's got a little more height here than they had with that substitution.
Scully's going to have to rotate over to the point. Bedford's trapping whenever they can. Yeah,
they got a foul there, a reach foul.
Coach Dorman's urging his team to not reach. They're in a 1-2-2 half-court trap.
So Mazzurri picks up that foul. First Bedford's first foul. Inbounding the ball is going to be Tyler Donnell. Oh, ball's taken away by Scully. And he got another quick foul there as Scully was called for a reach there, too.
Yeah, we had this ref the other night in the semifinal game, and he likes to blow the whistle. So we.
Merrimack at 448. Ball stolen by Scully. He's got Gendron. Gets it over to Gendron. Goes up and it's blocked there. Nice rebound there by Rinko. If it goes, basket is good.
And one. That's a great job by Johnny Scully there, getting the steal in transition and giving the ball up. Gendron could have gotten the foul call. We don't have a great angle down there, but Mike Rinko always teach these kids, ever since we've been playing in third grade, always follow the break. Always follow the break because layups are often missed in transition. That's a great job by Mike running the floor.
It was an excellent, because Gendron shot got blocked and he was right there to pick up the loose ball and put it in. And he hits the foul shot there. So it's 9-2 Bedford with 4:40 left to go here in the opening quarter. Seems to be all Bedford at this point. They've got a swarming defense, Chris, which has caused some turnovers and has made Merrimack really rush what they're trying to do.
It is. That's what they're.
They're not giving Merrimack much to look at. Strong move in there by Merrimack, and the ball gets knocked out of bounds.
I think we have this ref really letting him play, because that was some contact down low right there.
It was. I think he was, I'll tell you, Tyler Donnell was not happy about it. I think he did get hit.
I don't blame him. He got bumped by Brown.
Nice move there by Scully. Goes around, and good defense, and they are letting him play, Chris. And then they call a tic-tac foul.
They're calling the tic-tac stuff, and then the heavy stuff they're letting you go.
Yeah.
You know,
makes it for interesting because you really don't know how to play. You don't know if you want to be too aggressive or back off.
Yeah, that's certainly. And one thing you want from officials is you want consistency.
Yeah, either call everything or call nothing. Yeah,
they got to find. They're trying to find their way into this game too.
Merrimack struggling still with that defense. As Gendron has the ball, takes a 3-point shot and it goes. 12-2, and we got a timeout Merrimack, and that lit up this crowd, Chris.
That is. Colby's always, ever since he's been an 8-year-old, he's been a big-time player. He's when the stage is at its brightest, that's when he steps up and is at his best. And you can see that today with the first hoop right after the game, and he's just a kid that just plays with confidence. And he stepped back for a step-back three for an 8th grader is a pretty impressive
and
shot.
And
right
he was confident the whole time. I mean, he didn't even think about it. He just dribbled that ball out, turned around, took that shot. And puts Bedford up 12-2 with 3:48. Merrimack needed to call that timeout. They clearly have no momentum at all at this point, and they've got to regroup and try to figure out a way to deal with Bedford's aggressive defense.
Yeah, Bedford, they mix it up on them. Bedford doesn't know what they're going to get. What Merrimack doesn't know what they're going to get, because last time they just had trouble with the full court press. But at the same time, Bedford's just sitting back. They're kind of trapped whenever they can, and they're going to look to run. They're going to run whenever they can. One thing that Bedford has done through the course of the year is they've played in spurts, and they have a tendency to let teams back in games. So hopefully in a championship game, they keep the intensity going for all 32 minutes.
Bedford's still in that extended zone there.
Yeah, it's a 1-2-2.
There's a shot from the corner. No good, and it's knocked away there by Rinko, but right into Merrimack's hands again.
These are clean rebounds that Bedford, with their size, should be coming down with. They just got to box out.
And there's a pass to really nobody there. I think McKillop was looking for someone to cut, and nobody really went and filled that lane.
No, they're just playing with a little bit of nerves.
They really are rushing things.
Jandrin will put this up.
Another 3-point shot, and
you
it goes short.
Twice.
And that's out of bounds from Merrimack ball. Good open look there.
Yeah, it's a great open look. You know, you're going to take that whenever you can.
12-2 with 3 minutes and 4 seconds left to go, and Bedford playing a full court press.
Now they're in the 2-2-1 half court trap right now, full court trap.
Merrimack's really struggling to get over. They're going to 10 count there.
They get a travel call. Yep, travel call.
It was close to a 10 count, so either way, Bedford did a good job defensively there. So what do you do if you're Merrimack? How do you regroup at this point, Chris?
You know, they're a well-coached team, and they've been down before, and we've seen him. Colby left another one short. He's just not following through like he did on the first one. I think that's a little bit quick right now for him to shoot. Sometimes when you shoot, you hit that first one, you think everyone's going to go down, but I think they can get better looks than that.
It's a confidence thing. Yeah. So we've got a substitution coming in for Merrimack. Keegan Whelan comes into the game. Merrimack trying to make something happen here with 2 minutes and 46 seconds left to go here in the first quarter. Bringing it up court is Michaud. Does a good job of getting it in. Three-point shot, and it's off. Rebound there by Merrimack. Up strong with it. No good. Merrimack just misses some of those bunnies. That's just unlucky.
They're missing
for
a lot of layups.
Another fast break opportunity as Gendron catches it, goes up, and it's blocked. Nope, they're going to call a foul there, and Gendron's going to go to the line and shoot too.
He's a very good free throw shooter. But that's just sometimes when these kids, there's only one ball out there and they're so talented, they don't share the ball. But today, you're seeing them make that extra pass, and it makes such a difference.
Gendron hits the first of his two foul shots, makes it 13-2. And that foul was on Whelan, who just came into the game, his first foul for Merrimack. And Gendron makes the second of his shots, so he makes both of his. And Bedford has backed off on that press now.
And now they're in a 1-3-1. They're mixing up between a 1-2-2 and 1-3-1.
There's Boss taken away again there by Rinko. Rinko goes the length of the court, and he gets stripped there. Out of bounds, good defensive play there.
This is one area where Coach Dorman excels in, is these out-of-bounds plays underneath. He likes to run some good sets, and they're often able to get, like this might be a shot to Gendron in the corner right there. This time he opted not to shoot it, but they run a lot of good sets at out-of-bounds plays. That was
and
a travel.
Travel there by Eric Brown.
Forgot and to put the ball down.
Merrimack had Danny Vanacek sub into the game. He's the one that did a good job of stripping the ball down there for Merrimack. So yeah. They're bringing a couple guys off the bench here to try to mix things up.
They're trying, but right now, I don't know if they have the answers. They would help themselves greatly if they were able to convert some of these shots.
And they've had some decent looks.
They had decent
balls
looks.
They
just
not falling for them.
And they're going to start falling if they keep doing a good job on the offensive glass.
Fakes a three-point shot there. Looks to get in the middle, and Eric Brown gets his hand on it. Now Colby Gendron going the other way to Rinko. Rinko goes up strong, and he's got a basket. 16-2, Bedford. Minute 38 left to go here in the first quarter. This is a complete surprise to me, Chris, as far as the score goes.
Well, I've seen these teams. I've seen these kids play since they were third grade, so I know what they're capable of. They played in a lot of big games, and they're...
Three-point shot not there, and there's a foul there.
That's a frustration foul right there.
Yep, as he hits Troy Meservey, who just taken the
Cam's
rebound.
Younger brother, yeah. Troy did a good job on the glass right there.
And we have not seen Glassman come back in. I'm not sure how he's doing on the bench there.
As we said, he was injured coming in, and falling on that early in the game doesn't help.
Gendron with the ball, looks for the three, passes up to Brown. Brown takes a three, and that goes just off the rim. Now Merrimack looks to go in a transition, and they actually had a couple guys down. They didn't see it that time. But they're getting back on transition while they just didn't see it.
Yep.
And maybe that's what they need to do, is try to convert those Bedford misses into some quick points the other way, get some momentum going. Gendron goes up strong. Yeah, and
that's another four shot right there. I think they can get
Merrimack bringing it down here. Talbot with the ball. Talbot gets across court to Dinanchek.
Could have been a travel there.
And taken away there by Gendron. Gendron on the fast break. Goes in alone. Nice layup. 18-2. Timeout, Merrimack, with 36 seconds left to go here in the opening quarter, Chris.
You know, as we talked in the open, that the talent level was heavily in Bedford's favor. And, you know, could Merrimack, one, come over that, and two, they got to play in Bedford's gym. We're going to be some tough obstacles for them, and so far they haven't answered either one.
Now, the one thing they have done well, it's just not consistently, is push up on transition. That the last two times down they had transition opportunities, and they didn't spot the guys that were down ahead of the Bedford guys.
Yeah.
And I think again that's not going to win the game for them, but it's going to help them get back in the game And right. you want to build on your positives, and that's really the one thing they've done well, and they're not recognizing it at this point in the game.
When you're a team that doesn't usually play fast, it's tough to play fast. So they're not a team that likes to get up and down, and you can see they're just not comfortable. They have those opportunities, but are they capable of converting them? We'll see. This remains to be seen. You know, at this point, if you're Merrimack, you might just look to hold for the last shot, because this 18 to 2 could be a 20 or 21 to 2 if Bedford gets a quick run out after a turnover right here.
Again, Gendron putting some pressure on all the way up the court. Bedford playing very aggressive defense. Merrimack is looking for that one opportunity, it looks like. Bedford is not giving him anything easy.
Never saved
nice,
the ball.
Nice job defensively by Rinko. Shot, and there's a basket there Andrew Michaud. Yeah,
that's just something that, you know, Mike should know, that you never save the ball underneath your own hoop. They basically just give them a gift right there. You're better off just letting that ball go out of bounds.
And Rinko has the ball knocked out of bounds with 3 seconds left to go in this first quarter. Michaud, who came off the bench for Merrimack, has all four of their points.
Yeah, he stepped in, made two nice shots right there. You don't want to pick up any fouls right here.
There's a three-point shot, and it was good if it went, but it was a little bit short.
Right on line. They could have used that momentum, but 18-4, everything, you know, this game right now is being played in the 70s, and that's where Bedford wants the game. Merrimack would prefer a game in the 50s. When you're down 14 points, you know, it's a long game. There's still a lot of time left. They got to just take it one possession at a time. At the same, for Bedford, they got to keep the intensity up, because sometimes they have a tendency to turn it on and off. If they put together another second quarter like the first, you know, then they can start smelling the championship right now.
Well, and the other question, at what point does Bedford go dig a little bit into their bench? I mean, they certainly don't need to spark things up, but do you give some of those guys a rest? I mean, obviously Bedford's got a deep bench. We talked
Coach
about
Dorman
that before. Coach
Dorman doesn't like to play a lot of guys. He does have a lot of talent on that bench, so you're not going to see him going too deep under that bench. He likes to play, you know, he does have guys, but he's going to probably play his five or six guys. With Glassman being out, maybe you'll see someone else rotating in there. So, you know, do they have to, you know, if they have to go to the bench, they're certainly capable of, because they are the deeper team, but that's just his style.
Yeah, no, it looks like we've got the same 10 guys that finished that quarter back out there.
Oh, there you go. Glassman's in there for...
Glassman did just come in there.
He's back in from Troy Reserve. Yep.
Glassman gets it into Brown. Brown, nice move to the hoop. And he was looking for a pass to Gendron, but I think he didn't realize how wide open he was.
He's better off taking the one extra dribble and going to the glass right now. They're going to run the same play for Colby to the corner. This
Colby
time he
with
takes
the three,
the shot.
And it's off. Glassman with the rebound. Taken away from him. And now Merrimack again looking in that transition. They do have a guy down the court.
Ranko's not getting back.
That's what I'm talking about, Chris. That's a good job of Glassman getting back. But Merrimack is doing a good job of running that court.
They're beating him down the court because Bedford's lazy. They're just lazy getting back right there. And those are the opportunities that Merrimack's got to see that.
Glassman looks like he's... he's feeling it after that.
Yeah, he.
At the line shooting two. Makes the first of those two is Danny Vanacek, again, who's off the bench. All 5 points coming from guys coming off the bench.
Did 12 come off the bench too?
Yes, he did.
Oh, yeah.
And he makes the other one, so 18-6. Bedford's got to be smart about this game. It's only a 12-point difference, and they've got to make sure they're getting back on defense and not giving any easy points to Merrimack. Rinko with the turnaround, no good.
That's Merrimack. Not his game. You know, he's got to drive the ball to the glass. He does not knock down that jump shot. Colby got away with a bump right there.
Nice move inside there by Merrimack, and it's a good call. It went off Merrimack's player's foot. He found himself in no man's land there and really had nowhere to pass the ball.
Yeah, he got caught in the air.
Now Merrimack's picking him up full court. Here, Chris, they're trying to make something happen.
Yeah, that's not going to be good for Merrimack.
Gully gets the ball. He easily brings it up over half court. Looks for somebody. He's got Rinko. Rinko to Glassman. Glassman back to Rinko. Rinko comes in. He's bumped. They're letting that go. Rebound Merrimack, and there goes Merrimack the other end. A little bit too far. And out of bounds was Eric Brown.
Eric Brown almost saved the ball underneath his own hoop again, which would have given him a layup. These guys should know better.
But Eric did a good job of getting back on defense.
He did. At least he's getting back. Other guys are not getting back, but is
Vanacek to inbound it for Merrimack. Oh, he throws it off off the hand and going all the way down the other corner. Scully. He goes up, makes a layup. 20-6. Good
That's
job.
A big hoop for Bedford because Merrimack was on a little bit of a 4-0 run right there.
It was, and that was just a pure turnover by Merrimack.
All right.
Unnecessary. And Gendron with a good job of pressing. Jenner takes it away, and he gets fouled as he goes up.
They call the shot before. They call the foul before the shot.
And that's Vanacek with that foul.
We're in a standing room only crowd right now here at the.
We are, and they're the Merrimack fans. They're at their feet too. They, as you said, they sensed that 4-0 run there that the Merrimack had. It was their shot to get back in the game, and then Bedford was quickly taking that momentum and neutralized it. Nice play to Glassman in the corner. Glassman to the free, in and out. Merrimack with a rebound.
And they've run that play four times now. You think Merrimack would be onto that by now? It's certainly working with the open sets.
Nice pass inside to Merrimack. Goes up. Jenner with a slot. Turn around by Merrimack. Out to 3-point line.
He got away with the travel there.
Inside. And the ball is taken away. And there goes Scully going all the way down the court. He pulls up. He's challenged. And they call a foul there. So he will go to the line to shoot two. With 20-6 with 6:20 left to go here in the second quarter.
Johnny Scully's athleticism has been key. He's getting a lot of steals.
And Whelan, he picks up his second foul of the game, Keegan Whelan for Merrimack, so he may not be in the game much longer at this point. And this is the first of the,
little flat, no legs on that shot right there.
And he comes out of the game. Whelan comes out of the game. And Vanacek comes out of the game, too. Vanacek, again, he's got four of those 6 points, and Whelan has the other two. So the guys that have scored are on the bench right now for Merrimack.
Yeah, so they do have a bench. They can play guys. That's two.
He misses that one. So he misses both of those. In for Bedford is Nick Leahy. And Glassman with the ball. Looks to set it back up. Gets it to
Colby's got to look to drive this ball to the basket. Oh, you got to wait. You got to travel there. So this is what Bedford's done all year. They dial themselves in, and this would be a good time for a timeout for Coach Dorman. They've just lost their focus and their edge that they had to start the game with. They're just getting sloppy. You can see it.
And bringing the ball up is Misho. Bedford does a good job. That's
timeout.
With the ball. And they call a jump ball. They're going to call a jump ball. It's Bedford ball?
No, Bedford had the ball to start the quarter, so this will be Merrimack ball right here.
Bedford is not pressing at this point. Misho bringing the ball up. And I correct you, Misho has four of the points.
Number four, yeah.
Yeah, Vanacek has the other two. So Misho is still out there. Merrimack with the ball in the corner. That's McKillop. McKillop drives baseline, gets it over right in front of us. Fake shot by Donnell. Donnell gets it back across court to Karansky, who drives, comes up under, nothing there. Rebound back to Merrimack. Cross court, 3-point shot, and it is no good. Comes off, Merrimack again with the rebound. That's three they've got, and he gets fouled on the pass.
Yeah, just hit him on the pass. Discipline on the boards. They're no one's boxing right there.
And Bedford's got the height advantage,
they
clearly,
do have the
but
height.
They're just not, you say, they're not finding their opponent in boxing.
When you do play a zone, it is sometimes tough to have matchup responsibilities because you don't have a certain player to box out. But they got to do a better job sealing off down.
Now that's Glassman's second foul. He's coming out of the game, and coming back in is Rinko.
List.
And Misho with the ball. Moves it around the top back to Misho. Misho looks in the corner. 3-point shot. It's blocked. And Rinko ahead to Jenner. That was a long pass there, and Jenner just not able to convert. Now Merrimack back the other way. And there's travel.
Yeah, you got to travel. So they're just having a tough time playing fast. That is where, their only opportunities have come off of the offensive glass and playing fast, but they just don't handle that very well.
No, Bedford is having a tough time getting the ball in, and they get it to Jendron, comes back as a safety valve with 4:50 left to go, 20-6. Jendron is bumped in the lane, no call. His shot goes 22-6.
That's where he's at his best, going to the hoop. Bedford's best defense this year, in my opinion, has been the man-to-man. For some reason, they're not playing that.
Nice strong move inside by Merrimack. Nothing. Rebound goes back up again. Nothing there. Battling again. Long shot. Nothing there. And Merrimack has to go off them. But those three rebounds, Chris.
It should not be happening. I mean, obviously Merrimack is just crashing the boards. That's their part of their game plan. But
Rinko gets it ahead to Jendron. three-point shot, that's no good. Rebound there by Leahy, and he gets it taken away from him, but they are going to call a foul on Merrimack.
Leahy's going to have an opportunity to go to the line shooting one-on-one.
Foul is on number 22, Danny McKillop. That's his first foul, and you're right, going to the line is Leahy. We got another sub in the game, Ryan Porter in for Bedford. He comes in for Eric Brown. Eric Brown comes back in for Porter. So I don't know if that was a defensive situation or what that was.
I think he just wanted to make sure he had some height on the court right there to give Brown some quick little rest right there.
Leahy misses the second shot as well, 23-6. Now Merrimack comes back at pretty good speed. Around Brown, but a good job of Leahy there on defense. Over to Scully. Scully brings it up over half court. Gets in the corner to Brown. Brown looks for the three, fakes, puts it on the ground, dumps it inside to Gendron. Nice pass there. It's 25-6 as Eric Brown was very patient there and found
great
the
look
open
by
man.
Colby Gendron, nice little off-ball movement right there, making a cut.
Bedford pretty aggressive in defense here. Gendron pressures the ball. Back out almost over the line there at half court.
They're just long up top. See, Colby's lance is creating problems.
Take a three-point shot, and that goes, just missed that. We're going to foul from behind. Number 22, Danny McKillop. I believe that's his second foul.
That's the 19th foul, so.
Rinko's going to go to the line here to shoot 1-1.
1-1. After all this, all fouls will be two.
With 25-6, Chris, with 3:29 left to go here in the first half, it's been pretty much all Bedford.
It has. You know, they kind of let them back. They never let them back in the game. But, you know, and Bedford's had a lot of wide open threes that consistently this year. They've knocked them down. But I think they've only hit the one three by Gendron in the first quarter. But they've missed like their last six. And then good shots around the rim. But if those are falling tonight, we'd be looking at a 40-pointer right now at halftime.
Absolutely.
They got to be able to close all teams. You got to be able to close a quarter out, especially close out a half. So right now they have a 21-point lead. If they can go on like a 10-0 run, this championship is theirs.
And Bedford's done a pretty good job foul shooting. Rinko hits both of his, and that's important, as you know too. You got to make the gimmies, and your layups are your gimmies, and your foul shots are your gimmies. 3-point shot there by Merrimack. It goes just short there. That was a good wide open shot that time by Vanacek, and just came up a little bit short. Gendron looks to bring it up over half court. No problem handling the ball for Gendron. He gets it inside, and he is fouled, so he'll go to line shooting two. Good job of Gendron to bring that ball really pretty much up the entire court.
Make a play. He's got the ability. You don't see, Colby's been a guard since he's been in the third grade. He's been able to handle the ball, which is sometimes when you see the big kids like that, they only have big man skills. So Colby fortunately was able to develop some guard skills, and he has the ability to handle the ball.
And that was the fouls on Di Grossario, who just come in the game for Merrimack, too. So Merrimack has had, I think, nine different guys into this game so far, Chris.
Yeah, they've.
Gendron makes the first of the two, but misses the second, 28-6, with 2:58 left to go here in the first half. For another turnover there, ball's taken away by Meservey. Meservey looks to get it up to Rinko, who shovels it ahead to Gendron with a travel. Great heads-up play by Rinko, who had nowhere to go when he was in danger of traveling. He shoveled to Gendron, and Gendron is not able to finish it off there. And we've got another substitution coming in for Merrimack. Back into the game is Zach LeChance, who had come out early in foul trouble for Merrimack early in that first quarter.
Yeah, there's no point saving somebody now when you're down 22 in the first half. This game is, if not already gotten away from him, in danger of really getting away from him here. So you gotta go with him.
Exactly. Nice baseline move there, and his foul, I think they're going to call that on Eric Brown.
Probably Brown. There was no reason to even foul him. The guy was underneath the hoop. All you need to do is go straight up.
And that is Eric Brown, his second foul, and they are going to shoot two. Question is, does Coach Dorman pull Eric out of the game for the rest of the quarter or not?
I think he does. He's always been pretty conservative with two fouls.
Here comes Brian Cameron. Looks like he's going to check in the game here. And first of the two foul shots is made by Karyanski. Brown does come out, and Brian Cameron comes back in with 28-7. 2:30 left to go here in the first half. Merrimack shooting one more foul shot. Merrimack is perfect from the line, 28-8 right now. 2:27 left to go.
Escali brings it up over half court. He runs into some trouble, gets it to Jenner, and Jenner looks for the three, and we got a timeout by Dorman.
Wise timeout, I think, there, Chris.
Yeah, I mean, with Glassman being out, Glassman's their point guard. He runs the show, so Johnny Scully is capable, but he doesn't kind of command the players on the court the way Matt does, so I think that they needed to kind of decide what kind of set that they were going to go in right here. Because they were running that weave against the man early. They have another set that they call Auburn, which they it's just basically a pass and screen down. But what I would look to do is I'd post up Gendron. I mean, Gendron's got a kid who's 5'6", you know, inches smaller than him. I'd get him the ball on the block, or even any of those guys, Ranko or Gendron, I'd get the ball on the block.
We'll see if that's what they've drawn up here. Benford will come out with the ball starting here around half court with 2:19 left to go here in the first half. In command of this game, at least at this point, Chris.
They are. They got to close it out. They got to be able to close out a quarter.
Jenner gets the ball back to Scully in the backcourt. Scully looks to bring it up. Merrimack is going man-to-man, so this would be the perfect time to do that isolation in the post. Gets it into Rinko in the low post, and we got a foul five.
They have mismatches all over the court, and they just got to take advantage of them.
That's the second foul to DiGrisario for a hold. Shooting two the rest of the way is Bedford. Rinko at the line. He hits the first of his two shots. And the second shot is up, and it's no good. Rebounded there by Rinko. Does a good job getting his own rebound. Brian Cameron, fresh into the game, gets it over to Scully. Scully over to Gendron. Gendron again.
That's a lot of pushing
isolation.
Going on right there.
Rinko back out to Cameron. Cameron to Scully with a three-point shot. It's no good, but good ball movement.
It's a great job making the extra pass. Once they make the extra pass, they're going to get good looks right there.
Bedford still in that zone. Fakes the three. Merrimack having a tough time with it. We got a minute 37 left to go. We got a kick by Rinko. And we got a fresh play here underneath the basket. Bedford continue to play aggressive on defense, Chris.
They are. Now they're in a 2-3 zone. Good hands right there on the tip.
Merrimack is in
trouble.
They're
close to a five count right there.
Trying to make something happen here is Karianowski. He gets it over to LeChance. LeChance back to Karianowski. Fakes the three, dribbles in. Ball is knocked away, but gathered in there by Talbot. Talbot back to LeChance. LeChance to Karianowski. He fakes the three. He drives. And we're going to foul on Brian Cameron, it looks like, on a push.
Puts them to the line right now.
So they're going 1-1 here with a minute 5 left to go here in the first half.
They got to be able to get a rebound here. They're due to miss one from the line, you figure, right? What are they, 6-for-6?
6-for-6 from the line.
They've only had one basket this game?
They've had one field goal and that's it.
And they're a good free throw shooting team.
Very good team. When you can score with time not running off the clock, always works to your advantage, and Merrimack has done that.
Merrimack's going to have the trouble of where their point's going to come from.
Another shot.
Are they going to be able to get to the line enough?
Well, they'll go to the line the rest of this minute before this half. That's for sure every time there's a foul. But they're still down by 19 points with 57 seconds left to go in the half. Gendron to Cameron.
They're in their Syracuse set right now, which is kind of a little weave. They're going to look to go back door.
Cameron to Scully to Gendron. Gendron back to Cameron with 46 seconds left to go. Back to Scully. He's got Meservey in the corner. He finds Meservey. Gets it up to Gendron at the top. Gendron just waiting. Dribbles right. Nice screen.
No reason to be in a rush when you got a 20-point lead.
He goes up and he's fouled.
He's doing a good job getting to the glass tonight.
31 seconds left to go. Gendron will go to the line here. We got a foul on...
They're shooting two, so Gendron's been a...
Foul is on DiGrisario. That's his third foul for Merrimack. Again, off the bench, he's picked up three in this quarter alone.
Three already? Yeah, they got 12 team fouls.
And we got coming into the game again is Ryan Porter, who came in.
Yeah, this
a
might
earlier.
Be just looking to protect Rinko from picking up another foul right now.
Rinko comes out. Gendron made the first of his two, and he makes a second. Gendron has been pretty solid
nice,
from the line as
up.
Well.
Yeah.
Strong move in there by Merrimack. Rebound there by Merrimack, taken away by Scully.
Ryan Porter's got to be a little bit stronger on that. Now you got to hold for one shot right now.
Jenner with the ball. Jenner makes a three-point shot.
That's just a bad shot right there.
He rushed that. Pass to Cameron. Good save there by Scully to Cameron. Cameron to Jenner. Jenner isolates.
That's a big move right there by Jenner.
33-10, and that's the end of the half. So Bedford 33, Merrimack 10 after first half of this game. A bit surprising to me, Chris. I'm sure you're a little surprised too at what we've seen.
I am. I have thought that, you know, talent level, these kids from Bedford have been playing together since the third grade, so they know each other. A lot of them played for Coach Dorman last year, so they come into the season, they know what they're running for sets. From day one, they're off and running. So the first game of the year for Merrimack, you figure it's going to be tough. But when they came back and played, you know, right after the new year, I thought they had closed the gap. But as you can see today, there's definitely, you know, a huge talent difference, and Bedford showed up ready to play. I mean, when you're on your home court in the championship game, you know Merrimack had to figure they were going to get Bedford's best shot, and they did. So now when you coach Austin, what do you do? What kind of adjustments? I really don't have an answer, you know, for him. I don't know what he can do. I think you noted that they scored 8 free throws and 1 basket.
Yep.
So 1 basket. Bedford does have the ability to just shut teams down, and they've done. Where they've been lacking is on the defensive glass. So they could fix that up a little bit, and Merrimack will really be in a lot of trouble.
I'll tell you the one thing that, you know, Merrimack has had a few shots. We can't forget that. They've had some good shots, and they just didn't seem to get the bounces and the rolls. Now, that could change. That's not going to bridge 23-point difference here, but it would certainly make the game a little closer. So if they keep taking some of those shots and not try to rush things, you know, Merrimack will get some of those to fall, no question about it. And maybe they need to go in there and try to figure out some way to bring a transition fast break game into it. It is not their game, but for a while it got them going.
If you lose by 50, or you know, it doesn't matter. You lose by 20 or you lose by 50, it doesn't matter. So they got to pick up the pace of this game. They're going to have to, you know, pick up full court, try to get some turnovers. Unfortunately for them, they don't match up man-to-man well with Bedford at all. But they, at this point, when you're down 23, you can't sit back in a zone. Bedford will just work the ball around, work the clock. And, you know, Bedford's not looking to win this game by 40. They're just looking to win. So Bedford's going to play smart. That is one of their weaknesses. Sometimes they do rush shots and they get a little bit impatient. But if Bedford comes out, play smart, they're patient, the clock is on their side right now. I mean, they have the home court and they have the clock on their side.
Okay, well, we've got about 6 minutes or so. We'll come back right at the beginning of the second half and bring the rest of this game to everybody. And we're back for second half action. We've got a couple seconds left here before they get this thing underway, Chris. We're going to be Bedford ball coming right at us.
With their starting five and third quarter. Looks like he's going to give it a go right here.
Looks like Merrimack's got their starting five in as well. So both teams are really going to give it their all here. And we'll see if Merrimack done anything to change their game plan or the way they attack this thing. At halftime, we're going to know that pretty quickly.
Yeah, we're going to find out right away. I mean, they can't go man. I mean, they've been in man, so they can't go zone because the clock's against them. So, this is a big show tonight. They got raffles going on. They got the national anthem being sung live.
And they've got
got BCTV here.
And they've got a full house here. You've got the bleachers are full, and you've got people standing all around this court. I bet there's another 50 people that are not sitting down right now that are scattered around this.
Great job, I must say, on BCTV's and Mike Currier's
job getting us
here tonight, because this is like the event in town right now. This is Bedford High School future. As far as I know, all five of these starters from Lurgio are going to Bedford High School. So the run of, you know, there's a lot, you know, more consistency with the coaching, and you know the run of kids leaving. You know, you're seeing less and less of that right now. And you're going to see, you know, Bedford obviously is dominant in tennis. They're dominant in lacrosse, dominant in hockey. And you're going to see basketball catching up, you know, to them. I mean, because with this group, you can see how talented they are.
Yeah, and as you said, you know, when you play together when you're from third grade on, it makes a big difference. You know how kids are going to act and react in certain situations, and it just makes things a lot easier. And so Bedford finally has that, you know, with our own high school now. And as you say, there's, you know, more cohesion with where these kids are going to go. It makes a big, big difference.
So Mr. Gendron, is he going to come out and dunk the ball? He tried to go between the legs. He couldn't get the ball between his legs. Half court shot?
I guess so.
Or is he going for the dunk?
Nobody booed him though.
He's
too big to get booed.
He's been one of the top. That was Gardner Gendron there, the father of Colby Gendron, who's the high scorer for Bedford in the first half. He's been one of the top men's league players for years, but I guess he just scored a lot of points on this court.
Yes. He's a little bit more comfortable about 30 feet closer to the basket.
He likes to be underneath. All right, this is what we're seeing. They're trapping, and this could be problems.
Again, if Bedford's just going to take a minute or two to adjust to it. Brown with the ball in the corner, he goes baseline, gets it inside to Rinko. Rinko up, no good. Rinko keeps it alive, taken away there by Merrimack. Going the other way is Kurianowski. And we have a turnover, a step on the line.
Yeah, he dribbled the ball out of bounds. So when I said this could be problems, when you trap, you're going to be giving up, you know, you're going to be giving up some easy shots right there. So, but you got to give them credit. They got to try to do something. They're in a man, so Bedford's looking to run their zone offense, which maybe they're a little confused right now because it is a man. Now he's switching into his Auburn call, which is his man set. Pass and screen down. Rinko doesn't have a dribble right here.
Rinko gets it into Scully, takes a shot. No good. Into the corner.
That's a little bit of a quick shot right there from being off 23. I think they got to just wait. This is one of those things, just pass the ball around and take nothing but layups.
LeChance
starts
moving inside.
That's great hustle by Colby getting back.
Yeah, Jenner does a good job of getting back because Merrimack was in that transition set again. Jenner brings it up. Gets it back out to Scully. Scully dumps it off to Brown. Brown, the pick there by Scully.
That's
by Glassman. Glassman with the ball. Glassman looks to set it back up, gets it over to Rinko.
Glassman should look to roll.
Rinko gets his shot blocked. Merrimack gets the ball and again, trying to move it quickly into transition. Up the court, goes up strong and knocked away there by Bedford. Gendron with the rebound, looking for some help. Glassman comes back to help out, but Gendron brings it all the way up the court, dumps it into Rinko. Nice play there by Gendron as he came up the entire length of that court there.
They just
35-10, that was the first basket.
Yeah,
missed
layups come back the other way from made layups. So, and it could have been a foul down there. Coach Olson was looking for a foul. You know, I think there was some contact down there. But for the most part, they're letting them play.
They have, but the refs have
underneath,
been more consistent.
Yes.
Since the beginning of the game. There's a three-point
That's
shot in the corner.
Ball,
it's no good. Rinko with the rebound there. He looks to push it back up in transition. He's got Glassman. Glassman looks at the three, doesn't have it. Moves it around. Ball comes into Rinko. Rinko finds Glassman. Glassman looks at the three, fakes it. Drives, comes in, no good. Rebound by Merrimack. Fast break the other way. Nice job by Merrimack getting down there, and we got a foul there.
No reason why Bedford. They had no one on the offensive glass. No one. And they still got beat down the court.
45, that is Brown. I think that's his third foul.
It is his third.
Brown. So I don't know if we're going to see a substitution yet or not. 5:37 left to go in the third quarter. There's still a lot of time left in this game, Chris. Merrimack misses the first foul shot
they missed. They were due to miss a free throw here. But,
and Brown does come out and Missouri replaces him.
Yeah, Troy gives you a little more of a perimeter game, but they're certainly going to lose Brown's defense. And he's been very unselfish today, getting some nice assists. Hasn't knocked down too many shots, but he's certainly capable of that.
Tyler Donnell makes the second of his foul shots. It's a 35-11 game. Missouri with the ball, gets it back to Gendron. Gendron with the ball, sets up at top of the key, gets it to Glassman.
Time is on their side. Time is definitely on their side. There's no shot clock right there.
That was a tough pass there by Glassman. Lucky it wasn't taken away. Missouri loses the handle on the ball, and now we got a foul there.
That looked like good aggressive defense right there.
Missouri thought the foul was on him
for a minute there. This is where they're going to run the.
Jenner will get the ball. Jenner goes up, nice move, no
That's
good
a
there.
Four shot right there.
And Merrimack pushes
they don't
the other
need,
way.
They do not need to four shots when they're up by 25 points. And getting, then
the
it's not getting back.
Nice move there.
I would
that
be
a
looking
great
at maybe
move by
taking
Tyler
time out. There's no reason to not get, you kind of hit on this early in the game. Their transition defense is weak. Just not getting back.
And Merrimack, when they can exploit it, it will make a little bit of a difference. I don't know if that's going to change the game completely, but it'll make a difference. Missouri gets fouled going up, and he'll go to the line shooting two. And a foul there is on McKillop. And if that's him, if it is on McKillop, that's his third foul of the game. And it is.
the fouls are starting to mount a little
bit. 4:44 left to go. It looks like Brian Cameron getting ready to
Ryan Porter checking in. Coach Dorman looked like he was unhappy with someone there. Maybe it's the transition defenses.
We got a lot of subs coming in here now. We got five guys coming in, three for Merrimack and two for Bedford. As Gendron comes out and Rinko comes out.
Yeah, he's
Porter into the game, Cameron into the game.
Coach Dorman's addressing that right now. Transition defense and then the early shots. They just don't need early shots.
Missouri makes the second of those foul shots. 36-13. 4:41 left to go here in the third quarter.
Bedford's in there 1-2-2 right now.
Merrimack looks to get something set up here. They just need to be patient, Chris. Maybe an inside-out game, look for a good shot just like that. Good shot, good play there, and just didn't fall for it.
Yeah,
but that's what they really want to do. That wasn't a forced shot.
That wasn't a bad look.
They played an inside-out game, and you just look for the open shot. Now Bedford, see if their transition here helps them. Cameron at the top of the
time
key.
Time is certainly on their side.
Cameron gets it to Porter. Porter to Missouri. Missouri at the top of the key. Bedford just moving around.
This is smart. Just take time off the clock. Let them come out and
expend some energy, too.
Yeah.
Porter with the ball. Porter looks for somebody. He's got to put it on the ground. Gets it to Cameron. Cameron looks to set it up. Cameron gets it over to Scully. Scully puts it on the ground. Goes off the leg of the Merrimack defender there. He might have got a little bit of a break there as he got trapped.
Yeah.
We got a timeout by Merrimack.
Timeout by Merrimack.
3:44 left to go.
He's realizing right now he's down 23. Bedford's just taking time off the clock. They haven't come out. They haven't really played well. Bedford's only scored, 33 at the half? They only scored 3 points here in the second half. The kind of intensity level. And sometimes that's tough. When you're in the locker room up 25, no matter what the coach says to you, you know the score. You're up 25. But, you don't want to let a team back in it. You don't even want to let anyone back. It would be great to see if they could just build on this lead. And they have a bench of 15 kids, very talented kids. It'd be, in a championship game, get those kids some minutes would be invaluable for their, this is a game you remember forever, for the rest of your life. So just to get any kind of playing time would be great for those kids. And they have the ability to run these guys out of the gym, but they just stop playing. They got to pick their intensity level back up.
Brown and Rinko back in the game for Bedford.
So you're going to see a set play here by Bedford, because Coach Dorn, we talked about earlier, is really good at these inbound plays.
Missouri with the ball. I think he was the second look on that one. The first one was Rinko, but he wasn't open.
Got to watch that skip pass.
Ball comes back to Gendron, now to Glassman. And they're playing man-to-man to try to...
Now they're in their Princeton little weave right now.
Scully gets it over to Missouri.
Colby should be cutting back door right now. He can get himself a layup. Oh, watch that pass.
Bedford caught a break there. Long shot there from the corner. Scully, no good. Ball's loose. Scully gets it back to Rinko. Rinko's falling from behind by Daniil. I think he picks up his second
foul. Yeah, Daniil's playing hard. You got to give the kid credit. He's playing hard all night. He's getting up a few inches to some of the Bedford bigs right there, but he's played hard. He's hit the offensive glass hard. That's a call that he was disappointed with right there, because it could have been a no call.
Rinko with the first shot, and he makes that. 37-13, 3:11 left to go here in the third quarter. Rinko looks to take a second shot, and it is no good. But good job on the rebound there. We got a jump ball. Merrimack.
Possession arrow to Merrimack.
Good job of fighting for the ball there by Keegan Whelan.
Bedford's in there full court trap right now. Sometimes a trap will get you back dialed in a little bit.
Oh, foul there. I'm not sure about that, Chris.
I don't know. What are you seeing there? He's a little confused. Where is
he pointing
the foul?
Also, that's Scully's second foul, but I didn't see it. I think it was just good, clean defense.
I thought it was all ball. He kind of grabbed it, but maybe he saw something on a bump. But for the most part, it's been a well officiated game.
Bedford backs off. They're bringing it up right now.
For the first time all game, is a man-to-man. And I think this is where they're at their best. You're going to see Merrimack have trouble getting good shots as they get an easy one. See what I know.
Nice move by LeChance. Good second shot opportunity. Merrimack, again, they're just not getting anything to fall. Three offensive opportunities.
That's been the story of the game. They've been getting that.
Keegan Whelan did a good job of keeping that ball alive.
Bedford Colby is swatting the ball there. So instead of just going up straight and using your length, that's a travel. Yeah, he got it. Yep. That's a great job by Matt stepping up. Not necessarily going for the steal, but the player, as he turns, sees the player there and doesn't put the ball on the floor.
2:34 left to go, 37-15. Jenner with a good move to get around. His guy goes up, a short shot. Rebound there by Whelan.
This is one of those.
Taken away there again by Glassman. Looks, pulls up for a two-point shot. No good, rebound by Gendron, and that goes in.
This is one of those things. Bedford right now, they're not making the extra pass. Early on when they came out, they were making the extra pass. They were getting easy shots. Now they seem like they're not making the extra pass. See, that, we were just talking about this. Instead of Bedford guys going up straight, they're looking to swat and make the big spectacular block. They just got to go up straight.
Yep, going to the line for Merrimack is Nick Karinowski. He'll shoot two, 39-15. 2 minutes and 12 seconds left to go here in the third quarter. He makes the first of the shot.
Bill, thank goodness they've been good from the line tonight.
Coming back into the game now is Andrew Michaud, who scored almost the entire first half worth of points for Merrimack. And again, making the second shot is Karinowski. So consistent from the foul line has been Merrimack. You got to give it to them.
Mike Rinko's got to look to give this up.
Nice pass to Mazzurri. Mazzurri with an easy bucket there. Good transition basket there. Tyler Danil looks to get it in. Nice pass. Oh, just not falling for Merrimack. Again, nice opportunity, just can't get it to fall.
The game's picking up its pace a little bit right now, which is... Got to kick that out.
Good job of Bedford being composed there. Jenner puts the ball down. He gets bumped, going to the hoop by Tyler Donnell. That's going to be his third foul.
Their fourth team, so they're not shooting just yet. They're running that same play. Merrimack did a better job defending at that time. That's a little bit too much dribble. He got away with one there.
Scully bailed him out of there.
Coach Austin's look on his face is like, oh man, it's just one of those nights for his team. Nothing goes your way.
Jenner
nothing
does
there,
a good job,
Matt. Just pull it out. That's a smart decision. Like a timeout, maybe? Yeah, timeout by Coach Dorman. That's a great job. You know, you got four in your pocket. Why not use it right now?
Glassman's getting a little hot dog out there, and it's you know, probably frustrating his coach a little bit. He got bailed out of the last one by Scully, and he got bailed out on a timeout there.
Yeah, I don't know if hot dog's the right word, but he does have that little
flair.
He's got a little flair to his game. You know, he's able to go. He's one of the kids that can go behind his back through his legs. You're not seeing him at his best right now because he just doesn't have that little burst that he normally has due to the injury. So his dribble's just a little bit off tonight.
Tell you, Missouri's put in some good minutes for Bedford today off the bench.
Yes, which is good to see. Troy's worked hard.
Eric Brown has not been in since they took him out for his third foul.
Yeah,
it's been about 5 minutes.
Colby's wide open here. If they find him, he'd get an easy layup off of this. Maybe make the pass down low. That's a
nice
great job
getting it into Rinko. Rinko misses. Good job of battling. Merrimack Dunale with a good job of hustling there. Doesn't save it, but gave it his all.
They got to get their focus back and start knocking down some of these layups. That's
no good.
That's a shot that you just do not need up by 26 on the clock. Oh, my goodness.
Another good job by Merrimack on the break, on the transition. They just can't finish it. But they certainly got ahead of
down.
That.
Number 11. What's 11? Tyler Danil. He's running the court. He's running them down. But that, as we said, missed layups come back to get you the other way.
3-point shot. No good. Wide open shot there.
Oh, man.
For Karinowski. 3-point shot, and it falls.
One of them was due to fall right there. That's just sloppy. You can see Bedford's just lost their focus a little bit now. They're getting sloppy with the ball. They're missing layups.
That was almost a travel.
Their turnovers tonight have been in the single digits easily. Right now, the third quarter is where they've had most of them. This is their Syracuse set where they just run a little three-man pass pick down. It's not really, you know, it's tough to get any real offense out of this set. But it does take the clock down, so you should start looking to go in about, right about 10 seconds, you look to go.
Good defense there by Merrimack, and you got a foul.
That's not a smart foul right there. With 2 seconds on the clock, you're going to give up a half-court shot, give it up. Don't foul right there in the backcourt. Matt knows better than that.
lucky for them, there's 2 seconds. I don't think they're gonna get much out of it here.
No, they might just try to throw the ball and they'll get a heave, unless they don't want to turn it over. So 23 points at the half. This is where we were at the half, right?
Yep, 43-20. Merrimack is playing a little bit better.
They are playing. They had some threes. They had some good open looks. They just weren't going down. They knocked that first one down. So maybe that'll give them some confidence.
And again, they continue to hustle on the offensive glass. They've gotten a couple opportunities where they've had 2 and 3 shots. And they're not always falling, but they're not giving up either.
No, they have not. They have not given up. They're beating Bedford down the court. They're outworking them on the glass, and they're just not as talented. So they have not given up. They're working hard, but they just don't have the athletes at the skill level that Bedford has. But
Tyler Dino's done a good job stepping up in the last couple of minutes there for Merrimack.
On both ends of the court, he's played hard all game.
And you can see him. He's right. He's been running around. He's not going to leave much on the court after this game.
Right. Bedford came out. They scored 18 points in the first quarter, and in the second and third quarter, they scored a combined 25.
We got 8 minutes left to go in this game. 43-20, Bedford, and we've got an inbound here by Bedford. So Jenner gets the ball all the way back in his end of the court, gets it over to Glassman. And we've got the starting five back out here as Eric Brown checks in to start this fourth quarter. No, I take that back. Missouri's in the game, so Rinko is on the bench. Glassman with the shot, no good. Comes up short. Merrimack looks to push it the other way.
Yeah,
and
he gets fouled,
but I don't know where he was throwing the ball to, because Bedford did a good job getting back that time.
Back. Coach Dorman's message got through that time. Brown and Jenner are running the court getting back right there.
Back, 31, so the foul was on Missouri. That's his second foul of the game. 7:39 left to go here in the final quarter. Merrimack trying to run a play here off the inbound. They've got to hurry to get it in. Taken away by Scully, but turned right back over. Wide open 3-point shot, and it falls for Merrimack. As that is Andrew Michaud. Comes up real big there, Chris, to start this fourth quarter off.
Yep. I'm telling you, once that first three went down, they got confidence with the other ones. Bedford slowed it down so much, they're out of sync a little bit, but the clock is on their side.
Eric Brown takes a good hard look at it, pulls up, gets it out to Scully. Scully fakes a three, still has the ball. Runs into Brown, keeps control of the ball. Getting clogged up now, good opportunity there for Scully. Tries to dish it to Missouri, tough pass. Dishes it over to Eric Brown. Eric Brown does a great job of getting it over to Missouri. Instead of trying to rush and force that shot, Brown found the open guy and did a great job.
You know what, that's just another bounce where it just went against Merrimack's way. They got the stop and it just bounced Bedford's way. The last two hoops for Bedford have been fortunate bounces. They got a trap going right now.
Brown takes it away, gets it over to Gendron. And Gendron taking his time getting up court. No point rushing here. You want to be sure about what you're doing. And Daniil's pressuring him. We're going to get a 10-second foul here in a minute.
You got to take a timeout. That's a great timeout by Coach Dorman, because according to my count, they were at 10. So yeah. I think the ref was getting ready to blow the whistle for a 10.
He was
going to
blow it either way.
He didn't know which way he was going to go, whether he was going to go violation
or timeout.
Good timeout. So this is one of those things. Have they played a great second half? No. But they're doing what they need to do to win the championship. And that's just taking time off the clock. And I don't think their shot selection is as good as it could be. I think Merrimack is going to get impatient. They're going to come out. They're going to trap. That's why you're seeing Bedford get so many layups right now. So if Bedford takes care of the ball and gets back in transition defense, the championship's theirs.
Well, we've got 6:31 left to go here in the fourth quarter. Bedford commanding lead, 45-23. And it'll be Bedford ball. Here on the inbound at half court. We got Scully going to inbound the ball here. Gets it back to Gendron. Same play we just saw. Jen now brings it up into the front court here and looks to pull it out and get it set up.
That's a bad pass.
Scully has the ball bouncing around.
All the loose balls are going Bedford's way, and they're turning.
Missouri with another great play and a good basket.
All these broken plays are just coming back. That's unfortunate for Merrimack.
And I'll tell you, Missouri's done a really good job of being converting in the right place at the right time.
I mean, he hasn't made a hoop outside of 2 feet, but that's right. He's getting down to the block. And another loose ball by Troy.
Missouri.
Great job.
As I said earlier, he's done a good job coming off the bench, playing some good minutes for this team.
He has.
Scully looks to take some time off the clock.
This is their weave offense, which they don't seem to really get anything out of it, but maybe it just takes time.
Brown with a long three-point shot, in and out, rebound Merrimack.
There goes Merrimack again.
On a break, force that pass in there, and knocked out of bounds by Bedford. He would have been better to pull up and just take the shot.
Take the shot, yeah. But right now, you're Bedford. You don't need three-pointers.
No, I mean, I'm talking Merrimack's case.
Right. Yeah, Merrimack, yeah, he would have been better taking a little six-footer right there.
He's trying to push a pass right through the middle that's, you know, off balance. Glassman comes out of the game, back into the game there for Bedford is Nick Leahy with 5:34 left to go here in the final quarter. Three-point shot by Merrimack, and that's good. That's Nick Karanowski. I think that's his second three of the game. Got a foul there by Karanowski as Scully was bringing the ball up the court.
Merrimack brought a pretty good fan base to the game here.
They did. They've been standing almost the whole game. They've been really supporting their team. And you like to see that.
It's tough when you score one hoop in the first half, but that's the third three for
Merrimack. They've come out with a little more confidence.
Yeah.
Three-point shot by Scully, it falls short.
I just don't understand the shot selection at all.
Another fast break opportunity for Merrimack, and they convert. Good pass there by Karanowski.
You're up by 20-plus points with 5 minutes to go, and the last three shots for Bedford have been three-pointers right there. And runouts the other way for Merrimack.
Missouri comes up the center pick, taken away there by Merrimack. Merrimack looks to push it back up. The gender puts the pressure on full court. Merrimack brings it up. Inside move, and you got a foul there as Zach Hansen, who just came into the game, went to the hoop. The foul is on, I didn't see who they gave that to. Number 10, John Scullis, he picks up his third foul. 4:42 left to go here in the game. And this is the first of those foul shots. We got a couple guys checking. Glassman comes in, Rico comes in. Out of the game is Scully and Missouri. Missouri's given Bedford some fine minutes in this game.
He did. When you're down by 20 points, free throws, which was their ally in the first half, you can't be missing at both ends of a...
Jenrin
thought about a three, which
Brown thinks about the three, takes it, and it's in and out. Rinko has it go out of his hands. Merrimack pushes it up. Good job taking it away there by Leahy. Leahy to Rinko, Rinko to Jenrin. He fakes the three, takes the three, and it's no good. Comes back out to Leahy, Leahy to Brown. Brown
the last five shots now.
Leahy with it, makes a good move, might have traveled there. Gets it to Rinko, nice shot by Rinko.
That's a good hands by Mike Ranko, cut back door. You like to see him use the glass there, maybe.
Yeah, foul there by Leahy.
Yeah, you don't want to be fouling stop on the clock. I mean, those fouls that they committed at the end of the third quarter are kept coming up to catch him, because now Merrimack, with the clock stopped, is shooting 1-1. Cuts it to a 20-point game.
49-29, 3:56 left to go in the game. And misses the second one. Now Jenner with the ball. Jenner being pressured. Needs some help. He gets it to Glassman. Glassman looks, he's double-teamed there. Gets it to Jenner. And they get it over that half-court line in time. Back out to Jenner.
So now they're going to their Syracuse set, which is their three guys. They pass and they pick down, and they're just basically, they might try to look for a back door if they can. Right here, they had it.
Nice job.
Yeah, I don't know why Glassman's even out there at times, because he just doesn't have his normal game, and he's hurt right now.
And getting hurt is a chance, Zach LaChance from Merrimack is hurt too.
Referees are on the wrong side of the court. They're both on the one side right now. They're not realizing that.
Ball goes out of bounds. Off Merrimack. Now they realize it.
Yeah, they realize they adjust. Lucky he was in position to see that.
Jenner with the ball. Again, looks to take some time off. They set up this little weave here.
Pretty soon, Merrimack, I don't even know, though, when you're down, but that's, now you missed the little bunny right there. He's just not himself today. But that's what they try to look for out of that set, is a little backdoor cut, and they got it.
Merrimack, they had the opportunity to get it to him earlier, and he held on for too long. He had a wide open three look in the corner, but they just couldn't get in the ball. Ball goes out of bounds. And it's Bedford ball with 2:49 left to go. 49-29. I tell you, Chris, this has been a sloppy 2 or 3 minutes for both teams.
It has. I mean, what Bedford did is they did what they needed to win. So you got to give them credit for that, because they're at their best when they're trapping on defense and they're out running. So once they stopped just being a little more aggressive, they became less aggressive on defense and became passive. That's how a lot of their points that came from. Is they were going from defense to offense to get their points.
But I'll tell you, the shot selection has been tough. A lot of three-point shots, and you don't need those.
No, they definitely don't need a three.
Eric Brown with the ball, and Eric gets it over to Scully. Scully's got it with 2:09 left to go. We got a timeout by Bedford. He's pulling guys off the bench.
Yeah, he's getting his guys.
Wholesale change.
This is a nice job by Coach Dorman here. He's getting 5 guys that haven't played. See if he gets them 2 minutes here. Merrimack elected to not foul.
So coming into the game, we've
got... Oh, they thought they were getting in.
Nick Mokas is in the game. We got Nick Mokas in the game. Connor Roberts is in the game. Justin Wiggins is in the game. And then you've got Scully and Glassman in the game. So you got the 2 guards off there.
Merrimack just walked on the court with 7 players. I don't think they're going to allow that right now.
So Bedford has really not much height here, but again, just trying to get some people in the game.
Yeah, they're just going to look to...
Ball ahead to Wiggins. Wiggins has the ball back to Glassman. Glassman looks to Wiggins. Wiggins with the ball back to Scully. Scully to Glassman.
Keep the ball, Jack! Keep the ball!
Nice move to the hole there.
Nice move by Connor Roberts. Coming in and getting a layup.
Too.
Crowd's happy for him right there. Nice little move to the hoop.
Ball comes in the corner there, inside. Glassman takes it away. Glassman looks ahead. He had Wiggins, but he didn't dish it to him. Gets it to Scully instead. Timeout. Bedford, minute 14. They're going to bring some more guys in here off the bench.
Yeah, as we talked about earlier, it would be great to see if they get everybody in the game, and they're able to do that. I think they got all 15 players in the game at this point right now. So Merrimack just elected to not foul. I mean, when you're down 20, fouling's not going to help.
There's no point.
Yeah, they could trap and try to get some steals and converts going the other way. But these kids have worked hard all year. Not a lot of playing time for them, so it's nice to see them get a little playing time here
Josh
at the end of the game.
Josh Kohler in the game for Bedford, and Connor Crowley in the game for Bedford as well. So you got everybody come in the game, has come in the game for them right now. Wiggins with the ball.
You got
Wiggins
the seventh grade team out there, plus Justin Wiggins.
He is taken away from him and
just uncontrolled right there.
Minute 1 to go here in the game. Bedford doing a good job here on defense, Chris, not giving Merrimack any easy looks.
It's like Merrimack went to their bench a little bit too, which is good.
They did. Shot goes short. Nice rebound there by Merrimack, pulling it out. That's Zach Hansen. Shot goes up, it's no good. Rebound there by Bedford.
Josh Coleman got bumped too. He's going to the line.
No, that's a 6 foul.
You know, you hate to see teams like that, down by 20 plus, committing. The ref's got to realize he's shooting 1-on-1. Not yet, it's a 16 foul.
Yep. Crowley inbound the ball. gets it to Wiggins. Wiggins pushes it up over half court. Wiggins comes all the way to the hole. Nice move and good take, and it doesn't fall for him though. Merrimack going the other way with 27 seconds left to go, 51-29. Merrimack is really being pressed here by Bedford, 19 seconds left to go. Nice jump move. Wow. Oh, and I thought he had ball on that, Chris, but Wiggins called for the foul.
Yeah, he got him on the elbow there a little bit.
So with 16 seconds left to go, Merrimack's going to shoot two, 51-29.
You know, not, you know, Bedford very impressive in the first half. I mean, they come out 18-4 after one. Second quarter, they were up 33-10. They did exactly what they needed to do. The second half, they kind of just managed the clock a little bit. And they're champions. You know, a well-deserved champion. These kids have won a lot of games together, a lot of championships together, and hopefully they're going to go on and do the same thing at Bedford High School and bigger and better things. A lot of these kids have bright futures, and it's been a pleasure to coach these boys through the years and see them accomplish their goals.
Peterson made the first of his two foul shots, and he makes them both. So 51-31, 20-point game. Eight seconds left to go. Loose ball there, fighting for it on the ground is Brendan Hughes.
There it is.
1 second. And that's the game. Bedford wins 51-31. They were championship over Merrimack in what's a great game.
Yep, the
crowd. Well-coached game for Bedford and a well-played game for Bedford.
Great atmosphere for youth sports right there, you know. Sold out gym. Both teams treated to a, both fans treated to a well played, hard fought game by Merrimack for sure. You could see in the second half they had more talent than they showed. I think the nerves playing in this gym was a little bit tough for them. But they were playing against a very good team. And the better team definitely won today. They finished off an undefeated season. If we get a chance, maybe we can talk to Coach Dorman and see where this team ranks up. Because he's had some great teams through the years. One team that jumps out when they had Roger Larrabee, who's, you know, now 6'8", and they had McInerney. They had some big kids, which was undefeated. They won a championship too. So this team going undefeated might rank up there as one of the best that they've had.
Yeah, they've got, you know, some good height. You know, you talk about some teams they've had in the past that have height, but you know they've got some, you know, some guys. And as you mentioned, hey, Glassman hurt, so we really didn't get to see what he's all about. But you know, he gave it a pretty good game considering that he came in banged up and was banged up early in the game. But they've got a real good mix of some bigger guys and some smaller guys too.
Glassman's going to go on to have a great high school career. He's a terrific player. You know, he's capable. I think in the semifinal game he had 20 plus points. Today he just didn't have it because he came in injured, and wouldn't you know it, the first play of the game he gets fouled, hit hard foul on the ground. So, but they have a lot of talent. And next year's team for Lurgio is not going to be as big, not as talented, but there's certainly some talented players that. They could look to go for a three-peat for their championship.
No, that is absolutely true. And, you know, we look forward to that. This was a lot of fun. And as you said, packed house. I think this was something that people talked about, certainly in Lurgio, but in the community. You look around, there were a lot of people here that don't have kids that are on the court today.
Yeah, when you and I worked so hard on putting all those high school signs up, this is kind of the vision that we had, right?
Finally paid off, right? Good community, good turnout here, and great game. So I look forward to seeing these kids as they get up through the high school. As you say, you know, going to be a powerful team as time goes on when they keep these kids together and they play at Bedford High School. It'll be interesting to see how they do.
Well, thanks for coming out to do the game.
Yeah, it doesn't look like we're going to get a chance to see Coach Dorman. I think he's got other things going on.
They have an award ceremony right now, yeah.
But anyway, it was a good game, and glad to bring it with you, Chris.
All right.
Look forward to many more.
All right. Thanks, Mike. All right, thanks. Good job.
I got to run.
Thanks, sir.
Once again, thank you.